complicated questions. I'll try really to be very short. You are already tired by my talk, and so I want to shorten your suffering. The credit problem, is it spiritual or is it financial? Well, the credit collapse was the product, let's be absolutely clear about that, of the consumer's orgy, which we practiced for the previous 30 years or so. Inevitable results. It could come a little bit earlier, it could come a little bit later, but it had to come. It had to come. I don't know whether you remember the moment when credit cards were introduced, but credit cards were introduced under the slogan, take the waiting out of wanting. In other words, consume now, pay later. Don't wait to satisfy your desires, do it right now. Which means that it was called to live on credit. It was called to spend money unearned. It was called to have consumption, not according to your means, but according to your wants, according to your desires. The result was inevitable, but to your question, whether it was a financial crisis or spiritual, I would say both. The spiritual crisis has been revealed by the financial crisis. What was revealed was that the mode of life, which we learned and started to apply for the 30 years, just before the credit crash, were unsustainable, that we have to change ourselves, that we have to change the ways, for example, of to pursue happiness without going through shopping. Because we learned that that is the only way of being happy. The more you go to shops and there are on the shelves things which will make you happy. Such old-fashioned happiness, I see quite a number of young faces here, so we probably don't remember that there was something like that. But the reason to be happy because of the work well done, for example. Or because you have a very nice a company and other people, you know, the what was called once upon a time instinct of workmanship, or building the happiness of people around you, helping them and seeing their glittering faces of gratitude and satisfaction. There were plenty of things in which people could find happiness, but consumer markets were very clever to reduce every possible non-involved in shopping ways of getting after happiness, to convert it to the necessity of shopping. Just one example, you remember Christmas once upon a time was a spiritual religious festival. Now it is a shopping festival. You know, you buy presents for all around, particularly for your children, who compare themselves, their gifts they got, the gifts other children got. And it comes by no accident, by no accident. We are working very hard in a very competitive labor market. We carry our email telephones constantly in our pocket, which means that we don't have an excuse when the boss is phoning and demands us an extra job, extra work to be done. We are always in, always available, always on the beck and call. But we may happen to be also a loving husband, a caring father, an excellent neighbor, and so on. So if you are constantly on beck and call, the boundary between the work time and the private time is completely effaced virtually because of this constant communication. You feel moral pain, really. You have neglected people you love, people who need your help, people who are around, your children, you should sit with your son or your daughter after hours in school, listening to all the troubles which were there in school and helping with the homework and things like that. But you can't because you are busy. You must prepare. We just at 8 o'clock in the evening got a telephone from your boss and you know that you have to prepare for tomorrow a very important report. And you can't refuse because there's a competition. And when it comes to the next round of redundancies, then you will be the first to go. So, fortunately, consumer market comes with the help. Well, you can't dedicate your time, you can't share life with your wife, with your children, with your neighbors, but you can buy a very nice present. And that will compensate, and that will compensate for the pain, for the moral scruples. Now, the more you go this way, the more you need to work hard, because you need more money to buy more gifts and more expensive gifts. So it is a sort of a vicious circle. And that's already, ladies and gentlemen, a spiritual crisis. We need to rethink and reform our concepts of meaning of life, of meaning of being together, living with others and for others. It's a very, very hard task to perform, but if you really want to draw not only conclusions in terms of the future of banks from the credit collapse, but if you want to really draw the long-term proper conclusions, then you have to understand that what this credit crisis performed is to opening to our eyes, unraveling that there is some deeper, very profound cultural, moral background to the collapse of a few banks.